Sing the welcome song called Welcome Song. Loss, and we feel that with you, but we know that we are with spirit, that we are born spiritual beings, and that we are always with spirit. We hold this truth in silence right now, and we reach out to you and to the family of the deceased with love, with compassion, and lift you up right now. It is with gratitude. Gratitude for nothing at all, only grateful that we say thank you. Thank you for this unconditional love in our life. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. Please be seated so we can have the service.
Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to have you here at Unity Church on the Mountain this morning. I'm Joan Muncy. I'll be your worship leader. At this time, I would like to introduce our worship team. Mary Orth on the keyboard. Dean Isley, music director and our spiritual leader. At the AV, and prayer chaplain, Clifford Stocking, and Maria Carroll is on the camera, I think. Anyway, we're just so happy you're all here with us. And the topic of Dean's talk this morning will be written on your heart.
Please stand, let us sing "We" as you greet one another.
We must together, we must together.
Within us.
Not a building, but a soul.
and bring forward the prayer box.
Got this all set up for John and then I messed it up. Anyway, for a purpose. A prayer box. We don't have to put prayers in anything. We only have to think them. In fact, we don't even have to think them. We just have to know what it is that we are praying for. For the Lord God Spirit already knows what we need. But we do this so that we connect symbolically with our own thought, with the oneness the Spirit is. We hold up our prayers in the prayer box, then we send these prayers as symbols of our own prayers to Silent Unity, where they are prayed on for over a month. So it is.
So it is.
Now the Daily Word, read by Shirley Upton.
Faith. Through faith, I create the good I desire. Faith is my guiding light. It keeps me hopeful when I'm tempted to doubt, and cheerfully when I might otherwise feel gloomy. Faith tells me that even when the sky appears cloudy, the sun is still shining brightly above the clouds. Faith gives me secure footing in the present as I plan for the future. Faith is assurance that I am never alone, that everything I dream and do is divinely inspired. Every step I take in the direction of my expectations is fueled by faith that they come to pass. All of the wisdom, power, love, and strength of God are mine to express only I can, leaving Timothy and hesitancy behind. I use these divine attributes bodily and with confidence. Faith shows me the way forward. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Hebrews 11:1.
Thank you very much, Shirley. And now, let us clear our minds and our laps and prepare ourselves to say our sacred Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory,
take this opportunity right now, in this moment, to pause, to let go, relaxing our body as we breathe, feeling that natural rhythm, that rhythm of the universe as we breathe in and we breathe out. In this moment, we release and surrender our own personal attachments, and we allow Spirit, the presence that is always within us, to move forward into our focus, that we may experience the presence of Spirit. We move our attention within. We observe without attachment as we feel the sensations within our body, as we notice the thoughts that enter our mind. We just let them flow by without attachment, only observing that they're there. And we move deeper within, closer to that place where we know the presence, where we know the truth that we are each spiritual beings, that we are not only human, but that we are so much more, and that we have within us written on our heart all of the guidance that we will ever need from Spirit. It is only ours to open to it and to allow it. And it's in the silence that we become aware of the presence. We become aware not with our mind, not with our brain, but we become aware with our heart. Silence that we see with the eye of the heart. It is out of this silence that we begin to realize the guidance that we receive from Spirit, that we see with our heart, that we know with our heart. And it is from this openness to Spirit that we receive this guidance, knowing that all is in divine order. Knowing that we have all that we need and more. And from this heart space, we can feel the gratitude that goes beyond anything the gratitude that just is. And it is in this spirit that we say thank you, and so it is. Amen. The title of the talk today is Written on Your Heart. And when you think about a statement like written on your heart, you have to think about that word heart and what does it mean and what does it not mean. You know, at Valentine's Day is a time when we see a lot of hearts. There are hearts that have little statements on them. The heart in our current modern culture is tied to the idea of emotions. But that's not always been the case. Back when Jesus was teaching, heart had a different meaning. In fact, he taught that blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Because in the culture that Jesus came from, the heart was an organ of spiritual perception. The emotions were seen to be centered in the pancreas, somewhere around, you know, down in here. I didn't take a nap. But they weren't in the heart. You know, if someone had a sickness that was related to emotions, it was yellow bile, it was related to the pancreas, and not a disease of the heart. The heart is an organ of spiritual perception. We can see that. We read in the Old Testament, we can look in Jeremiah in chapter 31 and verse 33. The Lord's Spirit is speaking through Jeremiah here. And says, I will put my law in the midst of them, and I will write it upon their hearts. In the midst of us, written on our heart. This is the teaching that Jesus had when he was growing up and going to Sunday school. And Ezekiel in chapter 36 and verse 26. A new heart will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh, a living heart. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my commandments, and you shall keep my commandments and do them. That law is written on the heart. And it's by seeing from the heart that we know. That we know what is ours to do. Imagine trying to follow the commandments that are written down without that guidance from heart. And Jesus showed us how to take this. Were the Pharisees not always, again and again, condemning Jesus because he wasn't following the letter of the law? That he was following his heart. He healed on the Sabbath. How could that be wrong? They got in trouble because they were walking along and they picked wheat grains to eat because they were hungry. And that was not following the written law. They were working on the Sabbath. So Jesus showed us that spirit within us is the law. I want to read from the Gospel of Thomas. Very interesting. In Matthew, we know that Jesus taught us how to pray. And that's where our Lord's Prayer comes from, as Jesus was giving us an example of how to pray. But as we grow in our spiritual growth, you see, we start with the illumined mind. We start at what Charles Fillmore called the Moses consciousness, where there's this law, and it's written down. But it's written on our heart. As we grow in our spiritual growth, we begin to know that the law isn't what's written down, but it's what's written on our heart. So in Logion, or saying number 6, the disciples ask Jesus this: "Do you want us to fast? How shall we pray? Should we give offerings? From what foods must we abstain?" Now, these are all things that are covered in the written law. And this is what Jesus says to them: "Stop lying. Do not do what you hate. Because everything here lies open before heaven. Nothing hidden will remain secret, for the veil will be stripped away from all that lies concealed behind it." That sounds kind of cryptic. Do not do what you hate. We know when we see from the heart what it is that's going to keep us in the flow of spirit. We know what is ours to do. And if we are about to do something that's not in this flow, that doesn't align itself with what we see from our heart, then that's something that we hate. Maybe that's not the best word to translate here, but that's what we're given. Because everything here lies open before heaven. And where's heaven? Right here. We experience the kingdom of heaven when we're coming from the heart. Nothing hidden will remain secret. You're going to know. It's written on your heart. You're going to know. That's what he's saying here. I don't need to tell you whether you should fast or not, because you know. I don't need to tell you how you should pray, because you know. I don't need to tell you whether you should give offerings, because you know. It's written on your heart. And when you open yourself to heart, you just know. I don't need to tell you what foods you must abstain from. We're not looking at the written law here. He's talking about what's written on our heart. And that's where we take that next step. We go from illumined mind to the awakened heart. And how do we get there? How do we get there? The illumined mind begins when we start to realize this longing that we have cannot be fulfilled by the things that we buy, by the stuff that we read. There has got to be something more. That longing is Spirit calling to us. And so we begin to study. And we begin to look within. We study. What do we study? Well, we study things that spiritual teachers have written. But most importantly, we begin to look at ourselves. We begin to look at what is in our consciousness. What is it that we give our attention to? We begin to notice that there's this constant chatter going on in our mind. And it just about doesn't stop. As long as we're awake, it's coming at us here, you know? And if something's not going on that gives us something to think about, well, we can think about what hasn't happened yet. We can worry about that, or we can think about what went on before that, and we can regret that, or we can be angry about it. We can let all those feelings come right back when there's nothing going on right now in the present that warrants that feeling. That chatterbox mind will just keep on chattering. And it doesn't rest until we lay down to sleep. And sometimes it keeps us from sleeping. So what can we do about it? Because as long as that chatterbox is chattering, it's loud. And remember, Spirit speaks in a still, small voice. So as long as that chatterbox is speaking with this amplitude, that still, small voice is a whisper, can't be heard. So it's ours to find the silence so that we can be pure in heart. Purity here is not a moral code. When we're pure in heart, the chatterbox is quiet. When we're pure in heart, we are open, we are empty, and Spirit can speak in that still, small voice, and we can hear it. It may not be with words. It probably won't be. But we'll know. And we can know that we're not pure in heart when we can see that we're in judgment. When we can notice that we're laying some judgment on somebody or ourselves, then we know we're not pure in heart. Because that heart is unconditional love. There is no judgment. It's a knowing and it's a giving. Seeing as God sees and knowing as God knows. Maybe you've heard the phrase or the word non-dual. It's seeing this oneness. And you don't have to think about it. So many churches have been divided because of things like predeterminism versus free will. In other words, do we have the free will to choose, or is everything preordained because God made it so? And churches have been divided over this since there's been churches. But when you're seeing from the heart, it's possible to see that both are true. And this makes no logical sense. Our intellect just isn't able to grasp how both of those things can be true at the same time. And so we divide and we fight about it. But when we see from the heart, we can know that yes, everything is preordained. And yes, we have free will because we participate in this. We are part of in whom we live and move and have our being. That Spirit is within us. And we are in Spirit. And when we can quiet down that mind, that chatterbox, then we can act from the heart. So, have you spent time in the silence? Do you spend time each day, however little it may be, just opening up and allowing the Spirit? Because as long as that chatterbox keeps at us, we're not going to hear that still, small voice. And it takes practice. The first time we sit down and we look inside and we open ourselves, that chatterbox just keeps going at us. It's almost impossible to make it be still. What do we say? Be still and know. Be still and know that I am. be still and know that I am God. That we are expressions of God. It is the ongoing creation that we partake in. And we are those instruments of Spirit in this world. And we can either go along like a robot, doing whatever pops into our brain, thinking about what are we going to eat next, what are we going to do for fun, what are we going to do on our job today, what did we do last week? Or we can move into the present moment in that still and silent place. And we can do this while we live, while we are in the middle of preparing the meal, while we are driving our car. We don't fall asleep just because we're in the stillness and the silence, especially not if you practice. I know when I sat down for the silence early on, I sometimes would fall asleep because I got so relaxed. There's a fine line there, but the more we feel this presence, the more we can bring it into our life all of the time. And that's when we begin to move from the awakened heart into the realized soul. It's kind of covered up. But when we're in the realized soul, we are in that Christed state. The Christ light within us is always shining. It's always there right now, but it's not shining as long as we keep being in that chatterbox. That chatterbox holds us back. It's like a dampening on our light. Freely flowing from Spirit through us all the time. We don't have to be afraid to let it shine. Remember that give? It is in giving that we receive. And we can freely shine that light without fear that there will one day not be enough. Because the more we shine it out, the more we get back. And it's this feeding, self-feeding cycle. Not a self-defeating cycle. Because when we are afraid or in lack and we're tensed up, now we're self-defeating. But when we open and we give, that light shines. It shines and we can't help but to affect everyone around us. I don't want you to take my word for it. I don't want you to believe what I'm saying. What I ask you to do, if it is something that fits you, is to begin to go into the silence. If you're already going into the silence, give it a little more. Spend a little more time there. And begin to notice that presence while you're doing other things. Bring it into your life. Notice how much easier the tasks that you normally do become when you're present during the task. And it doesn't matter what the task is. When you're present during the task, your mind becomes focused on right now. There's no... I don't know if you've ever been in the middle of something, you got a deadline and you're just hurrying and rushing and nothing's going right. Because you're thinking about something other than your task. You're thinking about the deadline. You're thinking about what's got to be done next. But you're not present with what you're doing right now. But when we become present, we get very efficient. And that thing's done. And now we can look ahead. What's the next thing? And we do that, and then we do that, and then we, and it just goes so smooth. You ever see, if you watch sports, when everything's clicking and the team is operating together, there is this, I'm not in the way to say it, but harmony, you know, team spirit, esprit de corps. And it's when everyone is operating in that moment. We're all doing our little part of what's to do. The same thing happens in our body. In our body, there's all these individual cells. And each one's got its thing to do. And when they work together, each one doing what it's best at, then we have wholeness. But when part of our body gets cut off from the whole, begins to think that it can be more, do more, and be better at this than the other cells that are meant for that, then we have things that are out of harmony. Dis-ease begins to happen. You know, have you ever really thought about what a cancer is? That's a cell that's just decided that it's going to do its own thing. And it just starts making more of them, more of them, more of them, more of them. And it's not operating with the body anymore. It's operating out of self-interest. It's become separate. It's disharmony. But when we can bring our body, when we bring ourselves into harmony, we are in that flow. And it really starts from our heart. It comes out of the silence. It comes out of the silence. So, the challenge is to be aware. The challenge is to bring that silence into your life more and more. More and more. That is what is mine to do. And it's for you to look within to see what is yours to do. I ask for baby steps. Spirit, what is the next thing that is mine to do? Let's just have a short prayer. Let's position our body so that we're comfortable in our seat. So that our back is maybe a little more upright than normal. And just breathe together. Breathe in. And release it. Breathe in a little deeper than normal. Hold it for a short time from the diaphragm. And release. And just resume that natural flow of breath, receiving from spirit and giving back to the universe. Giving and receiving. We move within and know all is in divine order right now. That the chatterbox is still there, but it's getting quieter because I'm not following it. I'm just seeing it come and seeing it go. And I begin to know ever more and more what is mine to do. I ask for gentle and easy and fun lessons to help me grow deeper in the spirit so that I may be aware of where the place that my attention is on, that I may choose to place my attention instead of being at the mercy of chatterbox. Gentle and easy lessons that bring me to the next step of what is mine to do. I am grateful. I am blessed. I am good right now, just the way I am. I am good right now, just the way I am. From this place, the light shines. It shines brightly into the lives of everyone we touch. Our closest kin, our church family, our community, the world. Without exception, this light touches everyone equally. This light of compassion, unconditional love, joy, peace, gratitude. And it is with this gratitude that we say thank you, and so it is. Amen. Let's stand and sing together. This song's not in the red book, but it will be on the screen. But I think it's one you know. We sang it recently. It's called Trust Your Heart to Lead You Home.
Ushers, come forward, please. You know what? Well, I think we're all, you know what? I think we're all here. Let us say our prosperity blessing.
The inexhaustible resource of spirit is equal to every demand. There is no reality in lack. Abundance is here and now manifest.
Into the other room is chaos. So hopefully I'll get some of that straightened out before I leave. Well, and like you say, you know, you really need guidance because everything is just tumbled up in there. Now you've got to go through everything again.
Yeah.
Trying to find a place for it.
Oh, thank you very much, Shirley. Debbie.
Yeah, I was, my sister spent some time in Alaska with a friend recently, and they flew back in on Wednesday. And they wound up missing a flight for their connection, and so they wound up staying most of the day in the Denver airport and then coming on home about 12 hours later than they were planning to come home, and hadn't slept for 41 hours. I took them up to the airport, took her friend home, and she came back with me. And because she was so tired, I got to spend an extra day with her.
Oh, how wonderful.
So that was a blessing.
Well, I will share something at my personal level. Like Grace, I am blessed with a wonderful daughter. And technically, he's my son-in-law, but he's like another son. But they are carrying me around and doing things for me. And all I need to do is send a text, make a phone call, and either one of them are there. Mm-hmm. And hallelujah, I am so blessed beyond measure. So, and I, okay, announcements. Does anyone have announcements? And we'll start with a wonderful
story. Well, I haven't heard from Donna Stone Reed about her class, but we are going to have a workshop. This is probably going to start near the end of the month. Taught by Donna Stone Reed. It's going to be on Sunday afternoons upstairs. Spirit has given me an idea for a workshop, which will happen when she finishes. And I'll give you more as I get more. But it's got to do with gathering to look at our own personal trauma in preparation for healing the collective traumas in the community.
Wow. That sounds wonderful.
So it won't be so much of an instruction as a practice that we'll do together. And it will also be on a Sunday afternoon after lunch, so we can go eat lunch and come back. We have Sunday school in the morning at 9:30 every Sunday morning. We're studying, we're reading and discussing Discover the Power Within You by Eric Butterworth. And we're getting near the end of that, and I'm thinking that it's going to be Lessons in Truth next. We got to finish this one first. And so it's been a slow go, but it's such good food for thought. Eric Butterworth is really and truly amazing. Why am I forgetting? I think that's it. Unless anyone else has announcements.
Yes. Well, okay. Then I think we're ready for our
prayer of St.
Thank you.
the light of God surrounds us. I am the light.
The love of God enfolds us. I am the love. The power of God protects us. I am the power. The presence of God watches over us. I am the presence. Wherever I am, God is, and all is well.
May everyone have a wonderful week. We're so blessed that you came here.